Good afternoon, everyone, and it's a pleasure to be here this this day for the Value Institute. I think it's a terrific initiative to get a conversation going that's so important about, you know, how to basically change, evolve, and create innovation in an industry that's challenged with a lot of the mega trends that we heard this morning. Since I'm from the banking industry, it's a little bit interesting all morning listening to some of the challenges and directions of what's happening in healthcare, and all what I kept doing was making notes saying, yep, I got that one, yep, I got that one. So I don't know, maybe we could just change it and it wouldn't be much different. So let me tell you just a little bit about the financial industry and see if some of this resonates with you. It is a very large regulated industry driven by compliance, paperwork, filling out forms, a tremendous huge political lobby, huge trade associations, and supply side driven. The whole financial service industry basically says, we love innovation, we love new things, long as it doesn't change the bottom line, and long as everybody basically stays in the order in which they're there, and we like to just continue to keep making money. So if you have any new ideas that moves the industry forward, long as it doesn't affect me, we're all okay with it. The best example I can give you for that, and something that may be close and dear to your hearts, was in all of the major trends in the banking industry in the last 35 years, the consumer has always been way ahead of the industry players themselves. The adoption rate for credit cards started out in 1974. The industry thought this was going to be a very slow kind of evolution, and it ended up basically running ahead of all the projections, and of course has permeated the whole marketplace. It was the same thing with ATM machines, debit cards, all kinds of products that have come out, and they have basically very quickly picked up by consumers and moved ahead with it. So the industry, being supply side driven, has always tended to use technology and innovation for dealing with the paperwork, and the back office has basically never applied technology and marketing consumer things to the front of the office, which is the customer facing things. The best poignant example about how an industry can go wrong is when you look at what happened with mortgages. 35 years ago, mortgages were in a very different place. Some bankers actually convinced the marketplace that a 30-year amortized mortgage should also have a fixed interest rate for 30 years. On the assumption that you needed some certainty about your payments. And so they actually conned everybody into thinking that if you did that, then you would have some certainty in your financial future. Well, of course, we know that every American moves once every 5 years, divorces every 7 years, so we're not sure what we need the 23 other years for. I want you to know that extra 23 years, right, funnels 80 basis points into Wall Street. So as opposed to having the biggest, largest retail financial asset on the balance sheets of 9,600 small community banks and institutions around the country, we have them all basically on a handful of money center banks in New York. So all of this mortgage stuff flows into Wall Street, which basically is heroin for the addiction of securitizing each and every one of these mortgages, which you and I as the taxpayers, we heard from Senator Coons this morning, we the taxpayer end up every 10, 15 years bailing out the mortgage industry, right? We're just in the process now of writing another check for $1.2 trillion. In 1992, we wrote a check for $586 billion. And we have a big problem because half the people are in the tent, the other half of the people are out of the tent. I'm not exactly sure what they're doing. but we're certainly going to have lots of commissions, lots of dialogue, lots of talk, lots of papers, but not much is going to change because there's just too many people having the wrong incentives, and all of our political ambitions, which are with the most noblest of intentions, like home ownership for Americans, have never followed through with clearly understanding the consequences of what comes with that. So now we have homeowners that basically in my industry are buying houses with no money down, getting second mortgages to basically come up to 125% of the value of their homes, take the after-tax deductibility of interest, which is there to help homeowners. They use that after-tax money to buy a pickup truck. And the deal with you and I as the taxpayer is basically, if the price of my house goes up and I get equity, it's mine, and I become more wealthy. If it goes down, then it's you, the taxpayer's problem, and I'm going to walk away from that mortgage, and it's your problem. And out the door goes contract law. While I'd love to give now an hour and a half presentation on what I think really think about the mortgage market, let me give you that as a simple example about when I got into the banking industry. Basically, the regulator said, you can't do this. The technologist said, I'm not sure it'll work. The industry said, you're upsetting the apple cart, and it just wasn't going to work. And it's the industry's attitude that we need to basically keep things under control because these are very important things. We're dealing about people's money. It's like dealing with their health. This is very important, and we can't mess around with that. And so we got to make sure that everything moves ahead, but in a very controlled type fashion. Well, the trouble with the industry, of course, is that in 30 years, they promised and promised and promised a better deal for consumers, and consumers are paying the same amounts of money and are being charged the same amount of fees. And whenever you shut down one thing through regulation, it pops out over here somewhere else. So at the end of the day, the consumer really doesn't get a better deal. So what do you do if you're going to basically try to change things in the financial industry and you basically have to take a different view? And I think with the leadership we have here at Christiana Care on the Value Institute, it's really about focusing on how do you change the attitude around value. So let me now run a short little video that I think will give you the raison d'etre about, you know, why one should do things differently.
Out here, you have real power. People compete for your business. Everyone buys from whoever offers the best product. And if they stop offering the best product, you go across the street and you don't have to pay a price for changing your mind. Our name is ING Direct. We knew he were not a bank, at least not like any bank you've dealt with before.
Every once in a long while, someone changes the game. Forever. They don't just improve the way the game is played. They don't just master the game. They begin with a clean sheet of paper. They imagine that they are the first, and they write history.
Okay, value. What's all this got to do with banking? Well, the road to happiness is probably not exactly what you think about when you think about money. It's usually like the same kind of feeling you have when you have to go to the dentist. It's not a fun experience. But there's a way to basically change it, to get people to change their perception. And so the first thing you do is you don't actually even use the word bank. Like, it would be actually good to actually not even call it a hospital. That might be good. So I think the name is really good, Bob. Care, I think, is really, really great. But you have to change the way everybody else is doing it. And we need bright spots. And in banking, there's everybody doing it the same way. So if you're going to do it the same way as everybody else, the chances are you're going to end up with the same results. You might run a little better, you might run a little differently, but at the end of the day, nothing really changes. So you have to turn the world a little bit upside down to find what customers really perceive to be value, not what rationally looks like value. There's a pricing difference, but it's amazing to see when you think about what people perceive to be high value. And it has really something totally to do with the way they interact with things like money. For example, people generally do not know very much about what rates they're being charged, charged, what fees they're basically paying. There's not a lot of transparency. So all of a sudden, if you give them transparency and you basically tell them what they're actually seeing and what they're doing, they tend to make better choices. And so that means you have a creative destruction process going on where you're basically bringing it out in the light and you get consumers to make clear choices about what options they have and what they choose to do. And it really requires you on the business model basis to do really three things that are really kind of critical. Some that may be interesting lessons in the healthcare business. You do have to change the product. You have to design a better product. And you have to secondly basically change the process. That generally means taking 14 steps and making them into 9. And you have to change and re-engineer the customer. Customers get used to the way things are done. And you have to actually re-educate or basically change consumer behavior. You heard a little bit about the next generations and the way technology is playing. You heard that from Dr. Nash about his daughter. And it's really true that self-service is where the whole world is going. And if we're looking at the mountain of costs that's out there, which is the same thing in the banking industry, how do you get your costs down? How do you get your margin up? A big aspect of that is going to be self-service. So how many things can you basically do through self-service? And all of the research would tell you that customers will not do that. What they really want to do is they want to do what they're getting and they want more, but they don't want to pay for it. And that's where that process of a little bit of tough love comes in, right? It was clear to me one day with my young son standing in line at a movie when the lady in front of me ordered a popcorn and a big drink, and that was $9. For popcorn and a soda pop. Yet that same customer was basically saying to me, I don't want to pay $1.25 service charge. The industry would say, let's work hard and convince her that the $1.25 is a fair price and a good price and what you should pay. The other option, though, if you want to really change the industry, is basically say, we're just not going to give it to you. You can't have it. So it's carrying a conversation with consumers that changes their perception about how they perceive value. And it was interesting as we started ING Direct and doing things totally differently with consumers, which is selling mortgages directly and actually keeping them, convincing them that they didn't need a 30-year fixed interest rate because they couldn't guarantee anything else. We actually encouraged them to save, and we said, let the mission be leading Americans back to savings. And how are we going to do that? We're going to simplify financial products. And we basically created an avenue for people to talk about money. And it's interesting, in kitchen tables when I was young, the conversation was all about money. It was about making enough money to basically get the groceries and deliver newspapers. The conversation around kitchen tables today in Main Street America is all around sex and drugs. And nobody's talking about money. And so creating conversations with people, 80% of our interaction with our 8 million customers always ended up being about talking about money and savings and budgets and, you know, how do we basically improve the quality of our life by basically making sure that we're not enslaved to our money, but that our money actually helps us empower our lives. So the social mission ended up being a very big part of basically how to not only differentiate from the rest of the industry, but basically create a virtual community that was interconnected through texting, through email, through websites, through all kinds of ways to basically get people to have a dialogue, storytelling about money. And the important thing about that is it required a totally different set of skills. If you think about this, you either went to, if you're part of a Catholic family, you went to either the priesthood or you went to be a teacher at a university, or you did anything but go into banking. And in banking, you basically needed two skills that mostly bankers don't have, which is IT and marketing. You heard earlier a number of comments made about lessons from other industries. In looking at the banking industry, there were no lessons to learn by talking to other bankers. There was no point in going to banking industry conferences because everybody's basically all talking to each other, all saying the same things, all having the convergent talk. So we decided the way to basically change things was to talk to people, other industries. So we talked to the airline industry, hotel industry. At the end of the day, the lessons that were most applicable that could actually change the way of thinking and create a different interface with customers was from the retail industry, the grocery store industry. There, everything was about margins, logistics, inventory, moving things forward. It was a very, very tough business. And so coming in as a discounter, running with high volume, low margin, running on half the revenue, one-third the cost, and about the same return on equity, required you to basically be not only self-service oriented, but basically change the way everything was done, from, in our case, physical locations, to turning around and eliminating paper. And you can imagine how many customers would basically say, wait a minute, this is what I always get. You mean you're not giving me that? And we'd say, no, you're not getting that. And people would get very incensed, and then I would have to remind people that in the United States of America, carrying a weapon is a right, having a bank account is a privilege. 41% of all of our customers came by word of mouth. People come and refer things, usually restaurants and clothing. You would refer to someone on a Friday night. Recommending another financial institution is a bit bizarre. But they did that because the pricing was all consistent, the experience was very consistent, and it was very, very short in terms of the interaction. Everybody in our industry tries to find a way to basically capture as much time and as many eyeballs as possible and keep you there as long as possible. We took exactly the opposite tack to make a clear choice for customers and say, we really think we're going to save you money or save you time, so we're going to basically make this as painless as possible, as quick as possible, and then get the hell out of the way. That really appealed to 270 million Americans. It didn't appeal to 30 million rich Americans who actually wanted the opposite. They wanted lots of concierge service, lots of contact, lots of advice, lots of education, and they had a very different approach to things. This got to be very, very important, because having the right customers with the right attitude is what actually ends up making a successful experience. And we operated on something in our industry, not much like unlike what we measure in healthcare, which is a net promoter score. People that would say good things versus people that would complain. And one way to make sure that if the industry, generally the financial service industry, runs at about somewhere between 5 and 10% on net promoter score. I mean, it's almost as many people are negative as well as positive. We ran up around 70%. You can't get that if you aren't very, very clear about what's being delivered, and you explain that to people, so you set the expectations and you set their perception about what they're actually going to get. And it was all about the small things. It was never about the big things. It's amazing to me, people originally said, well, it's about the rate. And we found out that even when we moved the rate, people came there because they voted with their dollars the same way they vote with a ballot box. You vote for a brand, you are what you eat, you are what you wear, you are what you drive, you are where you spend your money. That is who you are. And those conversations around that end up being extremely important to you. And once you recognize that and you actually deliver to someone exactly what they expect, their satisfaction is actually extremely high. And so when you're very, very good at marketing and technology, two interesting things happen. Technology allows you to empower the process. From the minute you park your car to the minute you get through the system and you're back in your car, every part of that touch point is a critical moment of creating a positive experience. And our business was from the minute you dial that phone number, and by the way, nobody wants to dial an 800 number, but you can actually tell people that if you actually answer it with a human being, they actually are okay with it. And if you actually walk everybody through it and it's one and done and it's the right experience and the job gets done correctly, and you can assure that it's correctly because there are no exceptions and it's done in a very uniform manner, customers are extremely happy. And then you have to do two very big things. So technology allows you to empower the delivery, allows you to automate, get rid of all the drudgery. As a side note here, I don't have to remind you what happens when you go to a family practitioner's office and the first thing the receptionist says to you, fill out the clipboard. I don't care how good your bedside manner is, you've just lost one, okay? I don't understand why in technology you actually don't even have my face on your screen. So when I walk into your reception room, you know it's me. And you can welcome me by saying, good morning, Arkadi. I'm really glad you're right on time because the doctor's gonna be with you in 30 seconds because we logistically programmed all this. And you'll be out of here exactly at 11:43. We're doing this with cabs now. We're doing telephones to get us onto airplanes. Surely to God, we know how to logistically manage people's time. I mean, that's got to be something. Now, I know a doctor's time is valuable. God, we want the doctor to spend a lot of time with the patients because that's where the value-added dimension is. But the whole rest of the experience is pretty abysmal. And that's not my opinion. I think that's just what Main Street is saying. When I found that out in banking, I basically said, look, we're going to change this. So you can basically only do banking with us one way, no exceptions. A to Z, I'm going to deliver exactly what you expect, nothing more. And people had a hard time understanding that. Because even though it can be short and sweet, it can still be pleasant and friendly. And I always equate this to, which may be difficult in this audience, I always equate this to dating versus marriage. In dating, it's a relatively short experience. It's 4 hours, well-planned, extremely well-organized, executed flawlessly, and the chances of a defect or a screw-up are almost zero. Okay? Compare that to marriage, which is 20 years of basically relatively poor planning. You have got nothing but endless opportunities to fail on execution, and it's a hard go. And there's little forgiveness. So if you are now on the consumer side, trying to deliver a positive experience where someone sees value in what you've delivered, why wouldn't you want to keep that short and sweet? So instead of getting someone in and out of a hospital bed by basically saying it costs a lot, how about I want to get you out of a hospital bed so you can go back and make love to your wife? I mean, wouldn't that be a better benefit than it's just costing too much to have you here? Which translates to most people in the street saying, we don't love you. But you actually do love and care about people. So that gets me to the marketing. I know you probably don't think marketing is a big deal in medicine. I can tell you that all of the people that work in banking don't think that marketing is a big deal. Their view is, we've got the money, you want it, you make us happy, then we kind of bequeath something on you. And then you fill out all the forms, and if you don't behave, then we'll sue the hell out of you. It's hard for those kind of people that guys maybe think that there could be a demand side to the world where actually you organize the business around the customer. My God, wouldn't that be a novel idea? So let me tell you how the thinking went, because I think you might find this a little fascinating. Started out the bank with a clean sheet of paper and said, what would really be important to a customer from a value point of view? And we asked people on Main Street, said, what is important to you? And they ticked off the requirements. Pretty simple things like, can you just look at me when you talk to me? Can you answer the phone? Can you let me find an easy way to do this or that? Or I don't want to be routed to somebody else. You know, one touch, one serve solution. So we said, okay. So we said, that's exactly what we're going to deliver. And that's about, and by the way, they wanted better prices. You know, lower cost, nobody wants to pay for it. You know, the same thing. So I want all these things, but I don't want to pay for it. So I said, okay, I'm going to give you a low price. And we're going to do a trade-off. We're going to give you a low price, but we're going to cut all this other stuff out. Well, we don't want that. Well, we're going to give you that anyway. We're not going to give you that. Then we did something that I think you would find interesting. We then basically said, if we had to deliver that revenue dimension, which is half of what the industry gets in revenue, we have to organize the factory, the delivery system, at one-third the cost. So out the door went offices, carpets, limos, everything else, right? And said, look, you don't need any of that stuff. Don't think of yourself like an institution. You're basically a delivery system. The value is to the customer. It's not to us. And you basically said, we got to automate. You can't deal with paper. You can't deal with exceptions. And so as we got in customers, we had the privilege, which we don't have in healthcare, but in banking, because remember, I told you it was a privilege. We basically said to people, you're just too much of a problem. You're not reading the material, even though it's only 58 words. It's not fine print. You're calling too many times. You're lonely in Florida, and you have no one else to talk to except us. and we said, look, you got to go back to Bank of America or Citibank or somebody else, because branches can take care of that real well, but not us. It was a bit of tough love. And those customers that tended to be Catholic said to me, because by the way, I'm a Presbyterian, so I'm sort of of the same genre. They said, but we didn't know. So we understood the difference between empathy and graciousness and being too difficult with people. So we said, we will give you forgiveness. if you change your behavior pattern in the next 30 days, you can stay and be a customer. And people changed their behavior in 30 days and they could stay. And the ones that didn't, they're over at another bank. but I want you to know that the people that went through that experience and got forgiveness, they went to the Tupperware parties and the Amway parties. And they told everybody the way you get to be a customer there is you have to behave yourself and do it this way. And then you'll actually get there. marketing ends up being a very important piece about branding. The most important thing about branding is that people need to know what you stand for, what your mission is. And it has to be very simple and straightforward. And people basically want to basically belong to a brand that represents some goodness that can improve their lives. So to me, it always seems like interesting in the healthcare industry, when you look at a brand, what do people think about it? Do they have confidence in the medical professionals? Is it in the delivery system and the facilities? You know, what is really the attitude that basically they build into the brand? And you have to tell people a lot about that. ING Direct in the banking industry, we had to tell people what we're gonna tell them, then we told them what they should remember. And so there's this thing about getting an email or an alert before you come, and then when you're there, and then when you leave, and when you follow up, to constantly reinforce all this kind of cognitive dissonance that you have to basically register. The other thing that I think is really important that I just want to point out is every industry has a different function. In the banking industry, I'm dealing with money. Now, you must understand that money really doesn't do anything. We don't send rockets to the moon. We don't save babies like we do in healthcare. And in my industry, it is just the time value of resources. Savings are really restrictive consumption. So all you really do is deal with the time value of money, and you provide that opportunity. It's like oil in the economic machine. Your job basically is to create as little friction as possible. And what does the whole banking industry do? Work at creating as much friction as possible to create as many tolls as possible, to collect as many fees as possible, because that's the structure of the industry. And so if you want to really get customers' love, you basically find a way to create less friction, and you find ways to make money based on productivity and efficiency, and you explain that to people over and over again. Why can you give me this good rate? Because it's short and sweet, and your call is only $5.25. And when you do an email to us, that only costs us 9.5 cents. The more you make that transparent about why the value proposition is there, the better people basically understand that and believe in the brand attributes that you are promoting, which is extremely, extremely important. So it's a sense of ownership, it's a sense of belonging that makes it very, very powerful for people to basically see what you're trying to accomplish. It's also interesting to see two interesting juxtapositions. One that Dr. Nash talked about earlier, about being online and you're either faceless or you're gone. It is true that when we started ING Direct in 2000, it was just the beginning of the internet. Al Gore was just in the process of inventing it. And we caught the wind, because before that it was started as a direct bank, which means telephone bank. Didn't use a bank. By the way, we opened up cafes for no other reason than just to basically have conversations about money. It actually nothing to do with business, so you might want to think about this. Airports are turning into places to shop. I can't wait for the day when I can come to Christiana Care and I can just hang out, have coffee, and talk to my friends and play paddleball. Because that would certainly change my attitude about Christiana Care. I mean, when I turn that corner off 7, I won't be frightened about what's going to happen to me today, right? I mean, it's a different kind of experience. But the whole idea of basically getting people to think about things differently is also the way their brains work. It is interesting to me now that we have a lot of ADD. We have a tremendous amount of, let's not study anything anymore. Why should I study this when I can just search it? And it's an instant search, too. All I'd have to do is learn how to ask questions right. So what's happening to our brains, and there's a couple of interesting studies put out by the Dana Foundation, that our brains are changing slowly but surely, because we are no longer able to think for 2 days consecutively focused on something like solving a major problem, like maybe Einstein did or the great thinkers of our time. We're going to have to take part of our population and isolate them over there and keep them away from the electronics, because the rest of us are all going to be neurally evolving and solving problems, outsourcing, open sourcing, right? So nobody's going to come up with any great idea or think through anymore. Everybody's going to come up with little smidget ideas, and they're all going to basically neurally network together. That to me is a fascinating story, because the other half of this story was my mother. Because when I started ING Direct, my biggest worry was, mother, I have a problem. I'm starting a bank, and all the people that have all the savings, they're older. Do you think they'll actually call? Because I won't have any places for them to actually visit. And mom thought about that, and she said, you know, son, you got to understand one thing. We're older, but we're not stupid. We can do email. And we're tired of looking at a different face all the time. We're tired of fighting for a parking spot. We can do online okay. Don't worry about us, son. And mom was right. We did have some people show up, though, and we gave them a cup of coffee. But that's where that went. So here's the other thing. In the branding thing, it was really important to battle for the mind of the customer to stay different. In the banking industry, you'll get sucked into this big supply-driven mass, because eventually the regulators and everybody else will tell you, okay, but you got to do it like this, and you got to do it like this, and do it like this. And in the mind, everybody then thinks all banks are the same. Now, 7.5% of all Americans change banks every year. 3.5% are actually good customers, badly serviced. Those ones you should have a shot with. The other 3.5% are manic depressives. They're unhappy people. They're unhappy with their dry cleaner. They're unhappy with everybody. And now they got you. And now they're up to you saying, it's your turn now to make me happy. Your chances of getting that done are zero. What you need to do with those customers is say, move right along to our competitors. They're right next door. You need to talk to them. They're going to work real hard because everybody says the customer's first. I don't know anybody in any industry that doesn't say our customer's number one. Our customers are most important. We have all kind of customer appreciation day. And then we turn around and we screw up half of it by putting a clipboard with a receptionist. Or how about TSA at the airport? I mean, we can go on and on here, but you get the idea, right? The most powerful person in Russia is not Putin. It's the hotel doorman that lets you into the hotel. He's the one that creates the experience for you. It's not the operation itself. Battle of the mind for the customer. So what this should tell you is, much like what you have in healthcare, is that money is a very difficult psychological item. It has rational components to it, much like in medicine, but it has a huge emotional dimension to it, which is, I think, the same thing in healthcare. You got to address the emotional side of the equation to tap the value. There's no rational way of explaining to somebody that this is value. Value is mostly driven by an emotional attachment. So perception. It is amazing to me how we constantly find a new frontier of addiction. I mean, we did see the tobacco. We've gotten through tobacco, I think. We've got through seatbelts, although I think we had to do a bit of supplier demand side. I think now if we take the buzzer away, I think most of us would still clip it on. We got the habit. We got through alcohol. We're through drugs. The latest thing now is sugar, okay, the addiction on sugar. So we understand that there's a big part of addiction. But it's also like that in every other industry. In banking, it's the same thing. Some people basically have very, very different emotional interactions with money. Some don't want to hear about it. Some basically only want to spend their time on it. Very, very different attitudes. And it requires a business to be extremely flexible and extremely light-footed in terms of moving with what's going on. It's an evolving kind of interaction with customers. Things that people wanted to do and don't want to do, you have to be able to adjust them on the fly. That's very, very difficult to do. But if you think about it, the quality of life question is what every other industry is attaching. The airline industry is trying to not just get you from A to B, but they're trying to basically broaden that footprint. The retail industry is trying to look at your lifestyle. Banking is trying to basically look at your lifestyle, and so is mental care. So I found one book in today's talk that I thought you might find interesting. It's a little book called If Disney Ran Your Hospital. I don't know if some of you have already seen that. Looking through this, right, by Fred Lee. And I thought to myself, well, I'm not sure we can turn the hospital, you know, into Disneyland. But the I don't know why that's so funny. Somebody would pay $286 just to basically come and walk through and go for a ride. I know it's funny, but let me just tell you this about Disney. There are some thoughts about learning some things from other industries. Technology, it's not just about the robotics in the operating theater. It's about using technology, about how to basically process patients all the way through. If you want to see how far this is getting now, right? Look in the cockpit of most airlines. The pilots are on iPads. Scary. I keep thinking, is this battery running out? But they're on an iPad. Like it or not, we're in this world. If you think about the ethical questions around mission, there's no way of avoiding it. We are exposed. In my business, the electronics, we're exposed to the world. You can get hacked in, account taken over. Things can be stolen from you electronically from anywhere in the world. And we as the United States We control the ports and the airports, and we control the borders, at least most of them except Mexico. It's amazing to me that we're not ring-fencing our country electronically. It is just amazing to me. And the amount of losses are staggering in terms of what damage is being done. And herein lies one of the cultural things that in the healthcare industry we can also basically think about differently. Every time we have a problem, like in my industry, it happens to be account takeover, identity theft, fraud, the industry's answer generally is, let's find a way to insure it, which always means the good guys pay for the bad guys. And it's culturally acceptable to do white-collar crime here. It's not acceptable, by the way, in Canada or Australia. They actually haul you off to jail, as in Israel. But here we tend to basically think it's okay to basically commit white-collar money fraud, which we pay for. So the cost of that is difficult. And so to make cultural change, if you're going to change a business model, is to basically put up principles that you're willing to basically fight for and that you're willing to communicate. So having statements around what you think is the ethical or principled positions about what your views are about your industry, as I did about mine, was that we basically communicated them to the patients, in my case, the customers. We told them, this is what we stood for. This is what we want to achieve. This is what we think is acceptable and what we think is not acceptable. It didn't please everybody. It's hard to please 310 million Americans. But you're going to have to take a stand because people want to know who you are and what you're all about and what you're known for, which I think is very, 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 very critical. So let me wrap up by basically saying this. Aside from the need to basically look at, you know, our operations in Delaware, for example, or in the greater Philadelphia area, we're also competing in a global marketplace. I was mentioning to Virginia over lunch, a friend of mine, right, just went to India, right, to have a heart operation done, understand, right? And he paid for it with frequent flyer miles. The doctors are all trained in the United States. When I asked him, I said, didn't you have any problems about that? His answer was, no, the doctors are well trained. I said, well, why'd you do it? He said, I just love the whole experience. He said, the hospital was like a hotel. There's endless service there. The pre-care, aftercare was exceptional. He says it was like going on a holiday. I didn't feel like I was going to the hospital. That's the world that we're going to be faced with in terms of competition. So technology is going to change it. Globalization is going to change it. The cost dimensions are going to change it. And it's not about the money that gets spent. In my industry, it's the same thing. The money gets spent just in the wrong places, on the wrong things. The aggregate amount of money isn't a problem. And if you want to know why that isn't a problem, nobody's having any problems buying sports tickets to see baseball games or hockey games. And nobody's having any problem buying video games or nobody's having any problems buying these things. They're going hot off the shelf. So a customer puts a little bit more value on this than some of the things that we're trying to accomplish. So in my business, what we had to do is basically adjust the business model so that the customer understood the value proposition, so that they would basically buy this choice as opposed to that choice. And that end up making customers happy. Happy customers end up talking about you positively. That tends to influence where the money gets spent, and that gets to influence what the politicians have to say, and that's how Senator Chris Coons gets elected. So thank you very much, everybody. Thank you for having me here today.